One speech in it I chiefly loved. 'Twas Aeneas' tale to Dido, and thereabout of it especially when he speaks of Priam's slaughter. If it live in your memory, begin at this line. Let me see. The rugged Pyrrhus, like the Hyrcanian beast. It is not so. It begins with Pyrrhus. The rugged Pyrrhus, he whose sable arms, black as his purpose, did the night resemble when he lay couched in Vominous' horse, hath now this dread and black complexion smeared with heraldry more dismal. Head to foot, now is he total gules, horridly tricked with blood of fathers, mothers, daughters, sons, baked and impasted with the parching streets that lend a tyrannous and a damned light to their lord's murder. Roasted in wrath and fire, and thus surcised with coagulate gore, with eyes like carbuncles, the hellish Pyrrhus' old grandsire Priam seeks. So proceed.
Oh, good sword, well spoken, with good accent and good discretion.
Anon he finds him, striking too short at Greeks. His antique sword, rebellious to his arm, lies where it falls, repugnant to command. Unequal matched, Pyrrhus at Priam drives, in rage strikes wide. But with the width and wind of his fell sword, the unnerved father falls. Then senseless Ilium, seeming to feel this blow, with flaming top stoops to his base, and with a hideous crash takes prisoner Pyrrhus' ear. For lo, his sword, which was declining on the milky head of reverend Priam, seemed in the air to stick. So as a painted tyrant Pyrrhus stood, and like a neutral to his will and matter, did nothing. But as we often see, against some storm, a silence in the heavens, the rack stands still, the bold winds speechless, and the orb below as hush as death, anon the dreadful thunder doth rend the region. So, after Pyrrhus' pause, aroused vengeance sets him new awork. And never did the Cyclops' hammers fall on Mars's armor, forged for proof return with less remorse than Pyrrhus' bleeding sword now falls on Priam. Out, out, thou strumpet fortune! All you guards in general synods, take away her power. Break all the spokes and fellies from her wheel, and bowl the bound knave down the hill of heaven, as low as to the fiend.
This is too wrong.
It shall to the barbers with your beard. Pretty, say on. He's for a jig or a tale of bawdry, or he sleeps. Say on, come to Hecuba.
But who? Ah, oh, woe. Had seen the mobile queen.
The mobile queen?
That's good. Mobile queen is good.
Run barefoot up and down, threatening the flames with bison room. A clout upon that head where late the diadem stood. And for a robe, about her lank and all o'erteamed loins, a blanket in the alarm of fear caught up. Who this had seen? With tongue in venom steeped, gainst fortune's state what treason hath pronounced. But if the gods themselves did see her then, when she saw Pyrrhus make malicious sport in mincing with his sword her husband's limbs, the instant burst of clamor that she made, unless things mortal move them not at all, would have made melt the burning eyes of heaven and passion in the gulf.
Look where he's not turned his colour, and there's tears in his eyes, privy no more.
Tis well. I'll have thee speak out the rest of this soon.